Good morning, dear students. This is Dr. Savita Tidme. I welcome you all in our next lecture of the subject Economic Zoology. And we have spent many lectures on the topic Economic Importance of Insects, right? We have studied the economic importance of agriculture, apiculture, lac culture, even the stored grain paste, even the household paste. We have studied a lot. Right, and we in our previous lecture we have studied the brief history of the agricultural paste as well as one agricultural paste, that is Jowa stem borer. We have already studied. Now let's see which are the agricultural paste which we are going to study in the present lecture. Okay, red cotton bug. So red cotton bug, Diplodocus singulatus. So here is the systematic position of the red cotton bug, Diplodocus singulatus. Now it belongs to phylum Arthropoda and it belongs to class Insecta. See students, the characteristic of phylum Arthropoda and class Insecta we have already studied, right? Now the order Hemiptera, it belongs to order Hemiptera. Hemiptera is the order of true bugs, right, in which the forewings are modified into hemielytra. Their half wing is hardened and half wing is soft, so that is called as a hemielytra. If the complete wing is hard, then it is called as a elytra, right? But in this case, means in the case of the plant bugs, the wing is half wing is hard and half wing is small, so called as a hemielytra. And the family Pyrochoridae. So this Pyrochoridae is a family of firebugs. Usually red colored bugs are there and also known as a cotton stainer, right? So it belongs to genus Diplodocus and species Singulatus, right? So let's see the distribution of this red cotton bug. So it is also called as a cotton stainer and are widely distributed throughout India as well as Indian subcontinents and Sri Lanka, even Philippines and Australia. Even within the India, if you see, it is in the northern portion of the India, especially as a minor paste in the northern portion of the India, like Punjab and Uttar Pradesh. Okay, so dear students, let's see which are the host plant on which this one is going to feed. So here is the cotton stainer or cotton bug, right? So reddish in color, somewhat orange in color, and black spots are there, hardened part of the wing and then softened part of the wing, hemielytra. Okay, it is very easy to identify this plant bug. Now cotton is, as a name itself indicates, it is called as a cotton bug, a red cotton bug because it is reddish in color, so red cotton bug. So it is feeding mainly on the cotton plant, but apart from that it also used to feed on the another plants. Which are they? They are nothing but the ladyfinger, hollyhock, hemp, right? So even along with that, okra, copoc, jute plant are also mostly affected by this one. Means are also preferred as a food plant by the cotton bug, red cotton bug. Now, how you can identify, how one can identify this red cotton bug? Let's see identification marks of the red cotton bug. So it is very easy to identify. The size 12 to 15 mm in length and they are crimson, bright red in color. On the, or you can say on the basis of their coloration, crimson, bright red in color. So on the basis of that, you can identify easily the plant bug. Even their forewings, antennae, as well as the head portions are black. Okay, here is a black patch, black spots are there, antennae, eyes, triangular head is there, right? So on the basis of such a identification marks, we can easily identify the red cotton bug. Even hemielytra is also a characteristic feature. And this one, this is adult and nymph, immature stage of the this red cotton bug. So this nymph is what? It is immature, without wings, size is small, and rest of the things they are very common with the adult. Here you can see the small wings which are in a growing stage. Both of them are nothing but the plant pest, right? And they are provided with, means adult and nymph, they are provided with a piercing and sucking type of mouth parts, and with the help of that piercing and sucking type of mouth part, they used to suck the plant juices, they used to suck the plant juices from the leaves, from the stem, right? So ultimately imparting the nourishment of the plant. Now, life cycle of the Distercus cingulatus. How is the life cycle, right? So the insect is active around year, means throughout the year, and passes winter in the adult stage. They actively breed during the spring on their host plant, that is on the cotton plant, and they take the shelter under the leaves as well as debris of the protection, debris for the protection from their predators. So here is the picture of a life cycle where you can see the adult male, adult female. Males are smaller in size as well as compared to females, whereas the females, they are larger in size. Here is a cotton ball which is affected, or you can say on which these two members are found to be feeding, right? So eggs are laid in the form of clusters or bunches near about 100 to 300, means 100 to 130. 130 eggs are laid during the spring in the moist soil surface, not laid on the leaves, but eggs are laid on the moist soil surface as well as between the fallen leaf litters or in the crevices of the ground. And these eggs are spherical, bright yellow, and are laid in the clusters in the loose irregular masses of 70 to 80 eggs per batch or per mass. So the eggs are laid in the form of clusters, and it requires incubation for about 7 to 8 days. Incubation period is there, and then each egg hatch out into a small miniature of the adult, that is said to be the nymph. So first nymphal instar, second nymphal, third and fourth nymphal instar. So there are 5 to 6 nymphal instars, and develops within, means that 5 to 6 nymphal instar completes their lifespan within 49 to 89 days to reach the adult. Meanwhile, all the nymphal instars, as they have got the piercing and sucking type of mouth parts, they used to feed on the plant juices, right? They used to feed on the plant juices. Now, the last nymphal instar that grows, fifth nymphal instar that grows into adult. So, it develops the wings as well as the body size also becomes significant, right? And the wings again shows presence of spots, black spots, hemi elytra is there. When it becomes mature, then mating takes place on the plant itself, and then the females start laying the eggs. The adult can survive. The lifespan of the adult is again variable, but on an average, it can survive for about 3 months. Okay, it can survive for about 3 months. So this was the life cycle of the red cotton bug. Now let's see the nature of damage, how it damages the plant. So both the nymphal and adult stages are acting as a pest and suck the cell sap. As we said, adult and nymph, that is young one or miniature of the adult, they both are having the piercing and sucking type of mouth parts, and they used to suck the plant juices with the help of their mouth parts. So both of them, that is nymphal and adult stages, are acting as a pest. Even they used to suck the cell sap from the leaves, tender shoots, means soft younger shoots, even green balls of the cotton that are also affected, and the nourishment of the plant is ultimately affected because the cell sap is being removed, taken out by the plant bud. So due to the removal of the cell sap, the cotton balls opens at a premature stage, and from wet lint that comes out further attract the bugs, which then start feeding on the seeds. Right here you can see the image in which the red cotton bugs, they are enormously feeding on the immature ball, taking out the cell sap. Even right as this ball get open, they also feeding miss whatever lint or whatever fluid is coming out of the cotton, immaturely open cotton ball. It used to feed on the fluid as well as it also get attracted towards the cotton seeds, right? And as they feed on the content of the seeds, so present in the lint, germination capacity and oil content of such a cotton seeds is also getting affected. Here you can see the red cotton bugs feeding on the cotton balls, inside which what is there, seeds are there, cotton seeds are there. It also taking out the cellular content, or you can say the oil of the seeds. It feeds on the seeds, right? So such a seeds are again has got the less germination power. So the bugs stain the lint with their excreta or the body fluids, body juices, as they crushed in the ginning factories. Such a stained lint has low market value, which causes economic loss to the farmer, right? If the cotton ball in which this member plant bugs, if they are not removed properly, so by the rupturing, by the crushing of such a cotton bugs, their reddish colored body fluid comes out, and that stains the lint or fibers, cotton threads, right? Ultimately such a cotton threads has got very less economic value in the market. That causes a severe damage, or you can say economic loss to the farmer. They also facilitate secondary infection due to bacteria into the balls and causing rotting of entire content of the ball, which is then followed by discoloration of the lint to yellow or brown in color. So such a cotton threads or cotton is not even sold with the good price in the market, so ultimately causes a great loss to the farmer, right? Now let's see how we can control the pest population of red cotton bug. Now, as cultural, biological and chemical methods are often applied for controlling the pest population of the cotton or red cotton bug, right? So cultural methods, plugging the cotton field. Okay, why and how plugging can prevent the spreading of the cotton, red cotton bug? Any guesses, any idea how the plugging is, or it will be helpful for preventing the outbreak of a red cotton bug? Yes, because the cotton bug, that is female, used to lay eggs on the moist soil in the crevices under the you can say leaf litters, right? So when we plug the field properly, so the eggs which are hidden into the moist area, moist places, they get exposed to the sunlight, and ultimately because of the intensive sunlight, the such a eggs which are in the moist condition get dried out and will become dead. Whatever embryo is there inside the eggs will become dead, right? So plugging is again one of the cultural method which is quite effective against the controlling of the eggs. Okay, the second is hand picking. If you find some nymphal stages or adult flying or crawling over the leaves or stem or balls, so you need to pick them up and kill them physically, or you can throw them into the kerosinized water. So if you throw them into the kerosinized water, their respiration will be blocked and ultimately such a pest organism will get killed. Even the intercropping is also one of the criteria which is quite effective against controlling the population of such a red cotton work. What is the intercropping? So in between the cotton field, or yes, in between the cotton field, some another type of field which is resistant to the cotton bug, it should be sown. Or sometimes the crop rotation is also effective. If the cotton plant in the field, if a cotton plant is regularly being affected by the red cotton bug, then in such a crop, if the resistant variety you can put, you can sow, or you can say the variety of the plant means another type of a crop which is not evenly or which is not being affected by the red cotton bug. If it is sown into that crop, into that land, then ultimately, in absence of host plant, the red cotton bug, okay, what I'm saying, in absence of, though the eggs hatch out into a nymph and nymph trying to find out their host plant, but in absence of their host plant, that is a cotton plant, the nymph will get and die off, right? So ultimately, the crop rotation is also one of the important criteria, important control measure. Now, biological control measures are also suggested. Predaceous bugs or egg parasitoid are also applied to prevent the or to regulate the population of the red cotton bug. Even the chemical control measures, which involve the spraying of malathion, that is 0.05% of the malathion is being spreaded against the population of red cotton bug, which is quite effective, right? Even endosulfan, phosphalone should be applied. They are also effective against the population of a red cotton bug. So number of things are there to control the pest population. If you apply them, we can successfully control the pest population and prevent the pest outbreak. Okay. Yes, the next one is a brinjal fruit borer, as well as brinjal stem borer. Scientifically, it is called as a Lucinodus orbonalis. Okay, Lucinodus orbonalis, scientific name it is. So, this brinjal fruit borer, it is distributed widely. Okay, widely it has been distributed, that is found in India, Malaysia, even it is also found in the Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Germany, East Africa, right? And let's see what are the host plant on which this brinjal fruit borer will going to feed, or it used to feed. So brinjal is again one of the main host plant. Apart from that, solaneous plants like tomato, potato, sodom apple, nipple fruit, turkey's berry, and then gape gooseberry are also some food plants on which this brinjal fruit borer used to feed. So you can see it is a polyphagous in feeding, means it used to feed on the wide varieties of a food plant. So it is polyphagous in feeding. Here is the image. See, most of us have seen the larval stages of a brinjal fruit borer, right? Because whatever brinjals are we are getting from the market, though it is externally looks like quite good enough, but if you cut them, sometimes a small larvae comes out. That small larvae is a larvae of this Lucidonus, right? And when, if not disturbed, the larvae undergoes a pupation. After completing its larval lifespan, it undergoes the pupation, and pupa will hatch out into the adult, which is this nothing but the brinjal fruit borer, right? Okay, let's move ahead and see the identification marks, how you can identify this one, means adult or larva. All right, so the adult is again a small moth that measures about 2, means a 20 to 22 mm in wingspan. When the wings are completely spreaded from the broader margin of the wing, it measures about 2 to 2.5 centimeter, or you can say 20 to 22 mm in size, right? So dorsum of the thorax and abdomen has a pale brown or a black marking. Here you can see the pale brown or a black marking present on the thorax as well as on the abdominal portion, even on the wings also. So, hind wing is black specks and somewhat pale yellow discolored spots are present, and it has subapical black spot. Even cilia are also white. It has got some kind of a ciliary material or hair like structure which is whitish in color. A small moth it is, right? Then you can say how we can identify the larvae is of this brinjal fruit borer. So the larvae or caterpillar are somewhat creamy white when they are young and light pinkish when they are full grown. Light pinkish to violet in color when they are full grown. So if a whitish or light pinkish to yellow violet colored larvae, if you can see, so that is a larvae of the brinjal fruit borer. They measures about 18 to 23 mm in length, means it is again small, and head is dark sclerotized and provided with the mandibulate mouth parts, right? So this brinjal fruit borer is quite easy to identify. Let's see what is next. Yes, there is a bouncing life cycle of the brinjal fruit borer, which is Lucinodes orbonalis. So how is the life cycle? Here is a diagram. Yes, adult. Okay, so one can imagine how the generations of such a kind of paste are going to continue. How the generations can be continued? Yes, sometimes, or you can see, successive generations undergoes hibernation in the winter, that is winter sleep, right? And pupate in early spring. So when whatever difficult period is there, whatever harsh environmental period is there, harsh environment includes both, maybe the excessive cold or maybe excessive heating. So harsh environmental period is there, that is passed in the hibernated condition, that is you can say resting phase, and whenever the suitable environment comes, it become adult, right? Or it continue, it resumes its life cycle. So the life cycle, normally life cycle of this brinjal fruit borer, it completes in about 20 to 43 days, 20 to 43 days, but here in the diagram it is shown 34 to 59 days. Okay, and it takes about 5 generations per year, right? Now the female is somewhat elongated. Here you can see the adult of the brinjal fruit borer, and it lays white eggs singly or sometimes in the batches of 2 to 4 eggs per batch. And generally here you can see a single white egg is there. Sometimes eggs are also laid in the form of a batches, in the form of a groups, 2 to 4 groups per 2 to 4 eggs per batch, right? And the female used to lay near about 80 to 250 eggs during her entire lifespan, and these eggs are laid independently on the lower surface of the young leaves as well as on the lower surface. Here you can see the lower side of the leaf, rib is there, midrib is there, venation, right? On the lower side it has been laid, as well as on the bottom of the bud or calyces of the leaf fruit. Okay, leafy fruit has been laid. The eggs takes incubation for about 3 to 5 days. Once they are laid by the female, within 3 to 5 days the eggs hatch out in the summer, and if the environment is cold, that is in the winter, it takes a little longer time, that is 7 to 8 days are required to hatching for the hatching of the eggs. Then after hatching, the feed on emerges from the egg and bore into the tender shoots, that is soft shoots, near the growing point. And the larvae also bore into the petioles, tender stem or flower buds, but generally prefers the fruit, right? And there are about 5 larval instars, that is larval stages, and all of them, they are nothing but the potential pest which feeds on the either stem, either leaves, or specially on the fruit, right? So the larval period is variable within 12 to 15 days in the summer and 14 to 22 days in the winter. The larvae completes its life cycle, right? So it is again variable. Last larval instar undergoes pupation. It stops feeding and undergoes pupation in the tough silken cocoon, right? And the cocoon is boat shaped, gray attached with the stem or fruit externally and mingle among the fallen leaves. And the pupation period is generally variable from 6 to 17 days, after which the adult emerges out, right? And that adult lives for about 2 to 5 days, and females, they slightly live longer than the male, and within their lifespan they used to lay number of eggs, right? Now, what is the nature of damage? How they can cause damage? Everybody of us have seen the damaged fruit, that is brinjal, damaged brinjal, but we have to study with the diagram properly. Only larval stage is acting as a destructive pest. Adult is not the destructive, right? So the young larva bore into the tender shoots, which may drops down and dry up. So the tiny larva enters into the fruit by making tiny hole, which is not easily noticeable. It feeds within the developing brinjal fruit. Okay, within the developing brinjal fruit and destroys the whole internal tissue. And a healthy looking brinjal may contain several larvae within it. So the large holes are the exit opening of the last instar caterpillar for the pupation. When these larvae enters the leaf petiole of young shoot, they infest portion wilt or drop down. The infected portion get dried out and it is dropped down subsequently, right? So fruit borer is also one of the potential pest of the brinjal crop. Let's see how we can control them. Control measures of the brinjal fruit borer. So the pest can be managed culturally, chemically, and biologically. Cultural methods: uprooting and burning of the infested plants. Means what? If you find some plants are infected with the stem borer or brinjal fruit borer, you just have to pick them and destroy them, burn them out. As well as hand picking of the destruction of the caterpillar. If you find some caterpillars on the crop, so you need to pick them up. If you find some adult, you need to pick them up and kill them in the kerosenized water. This is a cultural method applied for controlling the pest population. Even biological control measures are also applied for controlling the pest population. Parasitoid to control the infestation. Some parasites, like wasps, some hymenopteran adult, they used to lay their eggs inside the larvae, and then later on inside the larvae, whenever another larvae is growing, the parasitoidal larvae going to use the content fat material and ultimately destroys the pest larvae. So predators which are like bugs or ladybug beetle, which feed on the larvae of the pest organism, they are also applied for controlling the pest population. Apart from that, the chemicals, number of chemicals are there in the market which are useful, as well as they are even regularly applied in the field. So spraying with a 0.1% carbaryl, then quinol phones इंडोसल्फान, क्लोरोफेनिफेरिफॉल्स एट अ रेगुलर इंटरवल ऑफ 7 to 10 days इज इफेक्टिव टू कंट्रोल द अडल्ट पॉपुलेशन. सो अल्टीमेटली इफ अडल्ट पॉपुलेशन इज अंडर कंट्रोल और अडल्ट आर ऑल गेट किल्ड, सो द लार्वीज विल नो मीन्स एग्स विल नो मोर, नो मोर लार्वी, नो मोर इन्फेस्टेशन, राइट. सो controlling larval population as well as adult population is equally important for getting rid of the brinjal fruit borer infestation. So dear students, in this lecture we have studied the life cycle as well as nature of damage as well as control measures of the brinjal fruit borer as well as what we have studied the life cycle control measures of red cotton bugs, that is Disturcus cingulatus. In our next lecture, we will study the two more agricultural pests.